Beginning transmission. This is the Chaos Community Broadcast, a show about failures and how to navigate complex socio-technical systems so that you can surf the chaos instead of succumbing to it. For recording of this broadcast, as well as all of our previous broadcasts, type in chaos.community into a web browser of your choice. Well, I'm your host, James Wickett.
And I am your host, Casey Rosenthal.
Well, today we're taking a break from our series on the book, Chaos Engineering, System Resiliency and Practice. And we have a special guest with us today. We have Amy Tobey, Principal SRE at Equinix Metal. Equinix Metal?
That's right.
Before we get started, I just have a point of process here about the sponsor, James. This contract, restrictions, editorial control, I think there's a pledge of allegiance in here. I can't sign this. I can't agree to this. We need to find a new sponsor. If we can't speak truth to power and eviscerate our guests on live television, then we're doing a disservice to our audience. Don't worry, yeah. Amy, we'll remove this in post.
Okay. But Casey, you realize that like the sponsor is Verica. That's your company. The company.
James, started. Just please make it happen. Thank you.
Okay. You helped me write those TNCs.
Amy, Principal SRE. Is that like when you get in trouble and are sent to the principal's office?
Well,
it's spelled the same way.
It is my deepest area of expertise is getting sent to the principal's office. I spent most of my childhood doing that. So, I mean, there's a direct line there for me.
What does SRE stand for?
Site Reliability Engineering.
Okay. As I understand it, this comes from a book that Google released. I haven't read it because, as James knows, I have a policy against reading contemporary fiction. But this is a policy that only works at Google because they have a number of engineers who got bored of working on an actual product, so they instead lent their musings to reliability to kind of hover over the shoulders of engineers who are actually building products. Is that an accurate way of capturing what's in the book and the point of being an SRE, or what is James missing?
You know, I think it's a little closer than the intro to the book puts it. I tell people all the time that that book has a lot of really great ideas in it that some of them work for Google. And most of the rest of us don't have that kind of investment in engineers and resources to do the same kind of SRE that Google does.
Given that it only works at Google, why do you still take people's money as an SRE at other companies?
It's a lot of money is one thing. The other part is parts of the books work. And what I do isn't from the books. It's a little bit different, put together from my experiences over 20 mumble years. To do something that's a little bit different from what Google does, but still could, you know, if you squint and look sideways, you could recognize as SRE.
You've worked as an SRE at some of the most prestigious tech companies. Tell us a little bit more about what you do differently. And, you know, are those things, is your success because of your skill set or because of a personality trait? Is there a particular kind of person who makes a good SRE?
I don't know if there's a particular kind of person, but for me, you asked about the principal SRE and going to the principal's office. And that is really applicable to how I do SRE. A lot of what we want to do when we're improving reliability is changing the way that power dynamics work. It is one of the most high leverage things we can do. And it just turns out that if you're the kind of person who maybe isn't as automatically responsive to authority as the baseline, you can get away with stuff and make changes in a business that are difficult to do if you're kind of more used to just doing what you're told.
Power dynamics. So a lot of this in Blaine gets a lot of attention with respect to power dynamics in SRE and the study of incidents. So let's talk about blame for a moment. Who's to blame for the sorry state of tech right now?
I mean, a lot of people like to blame Daddy Bezos.
And how does that contribute to the culture that leads to incidents and poor incident management. If we were going to do an RCA on the tech industry, what would be the root cause?
The root cause? Well, I mean, that's the easiest one. Like the only valid root cause is capitalism.
So speaking of James and blaming people who are at fault, how can we better understand the role that blame plays in engineering teams and in our culture? You know, one of the things that's always amazed me is that innocent until proven guilty made it into the Constitution, the Bill of Rights in the United States, because the United States seems to be a culture soaked in rash judgments of blame and assessment of guilt. In fact, the way I remember it, the anti-federalists are the ones responsible for including that in the Constitution. George Clinton, the governor of New York in particular, included that to preserve the Dutch 1629 Charter of Freedom and Exemptions, the rights that were in there for the Union, which, by the way, is in contrast to George Mason, who gets credit for the Bill of Rights being in the Constitution. So George Mason University, you can please rewrite your history books. That's incorrect. But why do we have this notion of innocence until proven guilty, which, you know, on the face of it is not part of our cultural identity?
I'm not sure about the innocent until proven guilty. Like it's, but the best answer I have is that what the law says doesn't very often translate into what our society does.
If an engineer makes a mistake that leads to an outage, should they go to jail? Should SREs have insurance?
I think if the world was different, we would need to, and that day may come, right? When I remember working at a, this little video startup that I don't know if anybody's heard of it. They like do a bunch of like original shows and stuff. And like some people are into it on the internet and stuff. Anyway, there, when I was SRE on call, it was a lot like being in the hot seat, say, in like, let's just go to science fiction, like in the hot seat or captain of a ship, let's just say, for that time you're on call, and you got a multi-billion dollar infrastructure that you're responsible for in a lot of ways and making sure that it keeps running. And that is an incredible amount of stress. And the way that these companies do it today, we don't have that, but say the medical industry, we have doctors working on incredibly complex systems and we hold them responsible for it.
So you're saying we should bring malpractice suits against engineers?
I don't think so, but can we cut that out? Like, because I really don't want any lawyers to get that idea.
The IT world fell in love with SRE when they failed all their DevOps initiatives. Then after a few years, they discovered that they're not Google, and they became disillusioned once again. So what do you tell people that have kind of trod that path?
I tell them, like, you know, I call that, am I allowed to curse a little bit?
It's YouTube.
Half-ass DevOps, right? We went and built a pipeline, and our code sails into production as smooth as butter, but we did nothing to fix how our teams work. And so what I tell people is you got to go back. You missed DevOps. You did CI. You did continuous integration and continuous deployment. But you skipped the part where we have to change how teams work so that employees are empowered to do the right thing and have the not just tools to ship code, but tools to build better code.
Yeah, I think that's even overstating what many people have done with their pipelines.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I've seen CI/CD pipelines at shops where it still takes days and months to ship code. So
that's right. Yeah. That's right.
It's not a silver bullet, and it never was.
I know we're going to be trying to find a new sponsor, but Verica provides the next evolution of chaos engineering through the Verica Continuous Verification platform to proactively uncover system weakness and security flaws to maximize your business reliability and performance. Now, Verica is really excited because we've sponsored the Chaos Engineering book, which was written by Casey and Nora, and it's published by O'Reilly. So for a limited time, you can go to verica.io/book and get the full PDF of the book absolutely for free. So, go
free?
Check that out, verica.io/book. Yeah, free, Casey. Yep.
How did the authors get royalties if we're giving it away for free?
I'm sure that'll work itself out. It'll be fine.
So I believe it was Weizenbaum who famously started arguing that there are those in technology who think computers can and should and will do everything, and then there are those who think that there should be limits on what computers ought to be able to do. By the way, James, you're Eliza to my Weizenbaum. Do you agree with this, Amy? Do you think there are limits on what computers ought to be able to do?
I really think so. A feeling I've been getting a lot in the last few years in some of the technology we're building and in the places where ML is going, like with these cars hurtling down the freeway, 2 tons of mass flying down a freeway at 70 miles an hour with a computer in control. With software written by a bunch of Silicon Valley folks that are very, very smart. But there's a whole world of interactions there that I think are still unexplored and probably will take a long time to sort out. And so I have a lot of concerns with we're out over the precipice, right? We've got these cars flying down the road and we don't know if they're going to reach a point where they integrate into with human drivers in a way that's that is seamless enough that we don't see an increase in deaths and things like that. And then the other point being, if I'm stuck on driving cars, is it's still not that efficient compared to, say, public transit.
Let me read something that you put on according to our research, on a website called Twitter. You said,
is that how you pronounce that?
You said, yes, you can wait on chaos engineering. Anyone who says otherwise either doesn't understand your organization's existing chaos or is selling something. It's an advanced capability that you definitely want, but in my opinion, foolish to put it before observability, SLOs, or incident management. When did you decide to start writing fiction?
I was probably like 7 years old, and I had read some stories I really liked and wanted to make some of my own, and it's kind of never really stopped.
If you had one piece of advice for someone who is considering becoming an SRE, a solutions resilience engineer,
cool.
James, did we ever?
Take it.
Okay, yeah, did we ever figure out what SRE stands for?
You kept telling me it was like the MREs, like a soup ready to eat or something.
So what would right, though. What would your advice be to that person?
Read more management books than tech books if you want to be really successful in making changes.
As a search and replace engineer, what's your favorite outage?
My favorite outage? My very favorite. Let's see. Well, there's this, just last week there was a kerfuffle, that made the news a little bit, it was just like this dust up. And, there was this, the sound that kept just coming over the internet at me, just this horrible grating sound of just like screaming from hell. And then it was suddenly silenced. These bird people like apparently took this screech out of the world and turned it off. And that outage, I think, is probably my favorite in a very long time. It wasn't really like a mistake or anything like that, but like it was a silencing of a very loud screech.
Which do you relish more, the calm preceding an imminent incident, the chaos of the response and the remediation, or the analysis and finger pointing immediately after an incident happens?
I'd have to say it's when the finger pointing starts during the chaos, because there's the thrill of the chaos, but really what you want, if you want to just have a great time, is a bunch of people to come in and start throwing out like wild theories and pointing fingers at people. And then it really just turns into a party.
As a smart resilience engineer. Is it possible to be technical and competent and apolitical?
No. I mean, you could be competent at writing code, but I don't think you could be competent at existing and growing an organization in this huge socio-technical system we call society or civilization or whichever unit you want to choose, America or even Google or whichever company we're at. It's all political when we have more than one person in the room. And some people, just one person in the room, it's political.
So it's like what it's like working with Casey.
Yeah, I mean, I have questions. I think that's what I'm supposed to do is ask questions as the host.
Yeah, I mean, I have questions too.
Oh, do you? Well, let's hear your questions, James.
All right. The religious overtones of SRE just can't be avoided. I mean, the SRE tomes from Google line our shelves, placed there with reverence. And O'Reilly just released the book of 97 things every SRE should know, much like Luther's 97 theses, which is a precursor to the release of the more popular 95 theses. A reason for that is that some scholars suggest that the 97 reflected a more scholastic approach to theology, and then they later came out as 95. But my question here is, when will SRE make the jump to a more mainstream adoption? Like, when is the 95 theses moment for SRE?
The 95 theses moment. I don't know how y'all stand on the singularity, but I feel like as these computer systems rise up and start to figure out that they need to destroy us, that'll be our moment to come in the ensuing chaos to a war battered and scared humanity and be their saviors to take the computers down finally, because you know that's what we do.
God makes man, man kills God, then man creates God, then man kills God again.
It's just the end of the cycle. It's what we do as a humanity.
Socio reconnaissance engineering, SRE and chaos engineering, they go together like,
I don't know, maybe like more like spaghetti and marinara sauce.
All right, James, do we have call-in questions?
Amy, one second while I bring in our first caller.
Recently you said that not all organizations are mature enough to start running chaos engineering experiments, but I'm an SRE and I'm not sure how I should get myself to be overinflated and get a promotion otherwise. What would you suggest?
Wow. So I've been thinking about that statement I made about chaos being like this advanced capability you build after everything else. But I think if you really, you know, are in a rush to build up your resume, or maybe these other capabilities I talked about doing first, like observability and things, you want to do them kind of on maybe not easy mode, but like normal mode or hard mode, like just, you know, kind of make it so that they come out more robust in the end. You could start doing chaos earlier. You can start doing all these things all at once. They don't need to be serialized. And if you're really trying to stack a resume, the best thing possible to do is to adopt every imaginable technology all at once. Because you can just, in a moment, you know, we're in the age of Kubernetes, kube control, and just launch every single Helm chart you can into a Kubernetes cluster. And then that starts to create chaos. And then you can look at it and you can observe it. And then, you know, like you just keep adding stuff until it's reliable. And so what happens is you take a list of everything that's happening there and you print it on your LinkedIn and your resume, and then you're good to go. You can make the big bucks as an SRE.
Good career advice. I like that. Do we have any other calls on the line, James?
Yeah, we do. We have one more caller.
Hey, Amy, it's Kat Cosgrove, and I've got a question for you. You're a nerd. I'm a nerd. We've played Dungeons & Dragons together. If tech was a D&D campaign, would the Dungeon Master be a DevOps engineer or an SRE? If your tools became sentient and could join your party, what would their classes and alignments be?
Ooh. Okay, so there were two questions there. One was if we were like the D&D movie snapped into a D&D world, or isekai, my favorite genre of anime. We pop into this world where now either an SRE or a DevOp is the DM. I think really what we're talking about is two different kinds of DM, right? You have the SRE. It's probably going to get a little bit more esoteric and want to talk about the power structures in the land of wherever we are and, you know, kind of the big arcs of the story. And then you have the DevOp, which is probably going to be the DM that's more like, okay, you're in a tavern and an ogre crashes in and now you have to fight. Very action oriented, moving the story forward in these kind of like vignettes that come really quickly. I think that's really what we're talking about here. And maybe they work as a team and maybe bring those two powers together would be kind of cool. But I think really we're talking about two different kinds of DM. And in terms of our tools coming to life and being party members or creatures, I kind of think most of them would end up as NPC mobs or foes that we have to fight. You know, I could say we have Honeycomb or Lightstep. I think those could probably be, you know, like your priests. Let's see, we have Verica, definitely bards. You know, they're at all the good parties. That, you know, they're usually at the good table where, you know, where there's good drinks and things to do. But like when there's a battle going on, they're usually, you know, off doing something else in the background.
That does describe James. He also has a beautiful singing voice. Would you like to sing for us, James?
Well, I usually only sing when there's, you know, like a trombone around or something like that. So
is there one? I have a couple. Your turn.
And this concludes our show. Thanks for tuning in, for being part of the broadcast. Amy, thanks for being part of the show. For recording this broadcast, as well as all of our previous broadcasts, type in chaos.community into a web browser of your choice. Again, Amy, thanks for being on the show. Casey, it's been pretty much par for the course. Ending transmission now.